Feels good to be back in the pulpit this morning. How did everything go while I was away? Did the numbers of the Fishing Craft come good this year?
Did they do a good job?
So, one of the things I'm actually trying something new. I'm actually trying to Facebook Live the sermon. So right now, if my phone is working, and I'm gonna practice not working it, but if it's working, it should be a live video streaming out to the internet, and we'll see how that works. So this is a big guinea pig test. I want to tell you the story of how I discovered that I had no future as an actor. I was in college, and the students in the intro to directing course had to produce 10-minute short plays at the end of the semester. They put out a call for volunteer actors. No experience required, they said. Nobody turned away, they said. I signed up, and at the first meeting discovered that one of the directing students would be doing a play about Galileo. And I auditioned. I wanted that part so much. I auditioned, giving it my very best, and was offered the role of the narrator, the offstage narrator. But it turns out the actor playing Galileo was really good. And as he was on stage, making at the beginning of the play, making his telescopic observations and his mathematical calculations, you could palpably feel him realizing that what he was discovering was revelation. You could feel the wonder and the excitement, but also the dread. The realization that revelation can be dangerous, and then the choice at the end of the play, the choice to continue to insist on the truth of his revelation and lose his freedom and his life, or to renounce what had been revealed to him, to be true to his soul. Lo, that word abideth ever, revelation is not sealed. Answering now to our endeavor, truth and right are still revealed. Those words from the hymn we just sang articulate one of the central theological ideas in liberal religion, the idea that revelation is not sealed. What this means is that the whole of religious truth and spiritual truth, the whole of human wisdom and human knowledge, is not something that gets revealed one time and remains the fixed truth for all eternity. What that means is that for us, one collection of texts written a couple thousand years ago is not the final and eternal truth. What that means is that for us, the revelation, the teachings of one prophet, is not to be considered the final, eternal, and immutable truth. Rather, for us, new understandings, new interpretations, new evidence, new insight are always possible. Truth is alive and evolving and emerging. Revelation is not sealed. The idea that revelation is not sealed goes back, way, way back in our history as a faith movement. After all, it was our religious ancestors, the Puritans, who believed this to be true as well. In fact, in the sermon that John Robinson gave aboard the Mayflower, he said these words, "I am verily persuaded the Lord hath more truth yet to break forth from his holy word." How in the world, you may be wondering, did a group of Puritans eventually transform into Unitarians? Well, I think a big part of it is that they believed that revelation was not sealed, that there was still more light to break forth in the world. And it was the strand of that religious tradition most open to new revelation that eventually followed a path to this tradition that we claim today. Wild, isn't it? In fact, our cousins in faith, the United Church of Christ, still hold on to this idea that revelation is not sealed as well. They put it this way in what has become the tagline of the UCC denomination. I like it. They say, "Do not put a period where God has put a comma. God is still speaking." I like that. So what are the ramifications of holding this theological position, of believing that God is still speaking? Well, if you believe that revelation is not sealed, it means that you'll regard new scientific breakthroughs as fascinating and meaningful, not hostile and threatening. If you believe that Revelation is not sealed, it means that you'll regard new movements of human liberation as beautiful and good, not as frightening. And if you believe that Revelation is not sealed, it means that you'll tend to regard the existence of other faith traditions not in a combative, dualistic way, where one must be right and the other wrong. No, you'll probably understand that Revelation has come through history in many different forms and will continue to come in ways that are sure to surprise and delight us. As the hymn we just sang put it, that which came to ancient sages, Greek, barbarian, Roman, Jew, written in the soul's deep pages, shines today forever new. So how's everybody doing? Does this make sense so far, what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Anybody confused? All right, good. Our church, being located as it is next to an academic community, and so I think this idea that Revelation is not sealed probably shouldn't surprise us. After all, evolving knowledge, evolving understanding is a big part of what a research university is all about. And I think so if you go to, I imagine if you go to the School of Social Work, or the Medical School, or the School of Public Health, or even the English Department, you'll find that some of what's taught now, today, this semester, is different than what was taught 10 years ago, or 20 years ago, or 50 years ago, right? Some is the same, of course, but some is different. In fact, probably some of what is taught now directly contradicts what was taught decades ago. And this, too, we regard as good and exciting, these breakthroughs of revelation. Although sometimes I would wager that these revelations can prove challenging to us if we're honest to ourselves. Has anyone here ever had to deal with the reality that there was suddenly a new way of doing things? A new, true way, a brand new way of understanding that makes our old understanding outdated? If Revelation truly is not sealed, then what that means is that some of the things we hold as meaningful, as true, as comforting, even as beautiful, may someday be challenged, maybe rendered passé by new revelation, and that can feel really uncomfortable. And that's part of it too, the beauty and the excitement of the novelty also comes the understanding that we may be passed by history. And there's another aspect of this idea that revelation is not sealed that I think is really interesting. If we hold as true that new light is always breaking forth in our world, what do we do? What do we do when we feel ourselves cut off from that source of revelation? Revelation can mean knowledge and truth, but it can also refer to our feeling of inspiration and connection. It can refer to our own feeling that we are being transformed. The reading this morning from Mother Teresa is probably the most powerful example that I can think of a person who feels herself utterly cut off from that source of revelation, which for Mother Teresa was God's presence in her life. And what are we to do with the fact that for basically the entire length of her ministry to the poor and the sick in the slums of Calcutta, Mother Teresa hoped to feel and longed to feel, but did not feel the presence of God in her life? For a period of 5 decades, she experienced herself as cut off, as outside of God's continuing revelation. And what are we to do with the fact that despite feeling abandoned and unwanted and forsaken, despite feeling nothing but emptiness and darkness, Mother Teresa basically kept right on track, caring for the sick and the dying as best she knew how? When I think of Revelation, another story that speaks to me is the story of Martin Luther King's kitchen table conversion, which he writes about in his autobiography. It occurs just a few days after King's 27th birthday, January 1956. He is in the middle of leading the Montgomery bus boycott, and the campaign has been dealt a setback, and it seems quite possible that it will fail. Late at night, King receives a phone call, and the voice on the other end of the line threatens to murder him. And so here is Martin Luther King describing his experience of revelation in his own words. He says, quote, "I got out of bed and began to walk the floor. I had heard these things before many times, but for some reason that night it got to me. I turned over and I tried to go to sleep, but I couldn't sleep. I was frustrated, bewildered, and then I got up. Finally, I went to the kitchen and heated a pot of coffee. I was ready to give in. With my cup of coffee sitting untouched before me, I tried to think of a way to move out of the picture without appearing a coward. I sat there and thought about a beautiful little daughter who had just been born. I'd come in night after night and see that little gentle smile. I started thinking about a dedicated and loyal wife who was over there asleep, and she could be taken from me or I could be taken from her. And I got to the point that I couldn't take it any longer. I was weak. Something said to me, you can't call on Daddy now, you can't even call on Mama. You've got to call on that something in that person that your daddy used to tell you about, that power that can make a way out of no way. With my head in my hands, I bowed over the kitchen table and prayed aloud. The words I spoke to God that midnight are still vivid in my memory. Lord, I'm down here trying to do what's right. I think I'm right. I'm here taking a stand for what I believe is right. But Lord, I must confess that I'm weak now. I'm faltering. I'm losing my courage. I'm at the end of my powers. I have nothing left. I've come to the point where I cannot face it alone." King continues, "It seemed as though I could hear the quiet assurance of an inner voice saying, Martin Luther, stand up for righteousness, stand up for justice, stand up for truth. And lo, I will be with you even until the end of the world. At that moment, I experienced the presence of the divine as I had never experienced him before." So there's King's story and there's Mother Teresa's story. Both are filled with longing, with pain and despair. Both call out to God. God answers King, not Mother Teresa. And yet both continue on with an inspiring degree of unwavering devotion and commitment and faithfulness. So let me pose this hypothetical question. What would have happened if King had not had that experience of revelation at his kitchen table that midnight? What if, like Mother Teresa, he had called out but not received an answer? Do we believe that he would have found some way to move out of the picture, some way to quit on the movement? Of course, this is a hypothetical question. But I believe deep down that even if he had received nothing but silence as a response, he would have gone on the same, gone on doing what he thought was right, just like Mother Teresa kept on doing what she thought was right. And I suppose that's one answer to the question of what we can do when revelation feels closed. We can just keep on doing what we think is right. I don't know about you, but what I've been feeling lately is not so much that the revelation is lacking in our world. What I feel like is, well, like what I think Galileo must have felt. What for him came clearly and powerfully as revelation is rejected for the sake of power and greed. It's not like we need a new revelation about our planet. We just need people to stop denying the revelations given to us by climate scientists and environmentalists. It's not like we need a new moral revelation. We just need people to stop denying the revelations about how we're supposed to treat each other, the poor and the sick and the stranger. Revelations that have been with us for a long time, ever since the Jewish prophets and Jesus of Nazareth. It's not that I feel closed off from revelation. It's that I wish revelation were a bit more revealed, if you know what I'm saying. So what does it mean to live with this sense that revelation is not sealed, even when the world feels at times closed off from revelation. I think we can take one lesson from Galileo. We can, like Galileo, continue to fearlessly speak the truth that we know. We can, like Galileo, continue to fearlessly speak the truth that we know. We can, like Mother Teresa, even in our time of darkness, our time of feeling cut off, even when we feel like there's nothing speaking to us, we can still continue to go forward and do what we know, what we think to be right. And like King, we can open ourselves to the possibility that new revelation may yet speak to us, so we might keep our ears open to listen. Amen. Blessed be. It's good to be back with all.